focus on how we can actually infer quantitative information from these palm measurements. Mainly, I will show you a couple of different algorithms that can be used to investigate clustering, so the spatial organization of proteins, and how we can ultimately count the stoichiometry of individual protein complexes. And if I still have some time, I will tell you a little bit about SOFI, an alternative technique that you can use for estimating the density of proteins in your sample. So why do we want to go to this trouble of doing super-resolution fluorescence microscopy? Well, we want to know more how a cell is functioning, and at the core of the cell, you have the individual molecules, proteins, small molecules that are organized in a certain spatial way that interact with each other. So if we want to see those, whoops, it's going the wrong way. They are very tiny, so they're below the resolution limit of your normal microscope. So we need to either use a fluorescence method that delivers us this high resolution, or we need to go and look at single molecules by just looking at a sample that contains very, very few molecules. And the advantage of doing super-resolution fluorescence microscopy is, of course, we can potentially also do this in a living cell, as opposed to electron microscopy, where we can also go to very, very high resolutions. And the other advantage is, of course, we can have biomolecular specificity, so we can tag our proteins of interest. So here I just show you a little bit of an overview of the different fluorescence microscopes that you probably all have in your labs. So I guess most of you have worked with a wide field or confocal or turf microscope. Maybe some of you even use light sheets or lattice light sheets microscopes, but still all of these microscopes are give you a diffraction limited picture. So what do I mean by giving you a diffraction limited image? Well, because we are using lights and lenses to look at our sample, we ultimately cannot focus our fluorescence light smaller than to this diffraction limited spot. And this gives us the so-called point spread function of the objective. And in turn, it's the same thing when you want to image a molecule, a point source, we image it through a lens and ultimately focus it on the camera. And we will only also be able to see like a diffraction limited blob of this molecule. Here you see the famous formula from Abe that tells you something about the width of the point spread function. Well, ultimately, we're limited by the wavelength of light divided by about 2, and we also have the numerical aperture of our microscope objective to take into account. So when we are really when we are talking about resolution, what we have to look at is when can we tell two of these point spread functions apart. And there are different criteria how to define this resolution. Here I have depicted the so-called Rayleigh criterion. And Lord Rayleigh said that two point spread functions that you see here can be discerned when the maximum of one PSF overlaps with the minimum first minimum of the other PSF. And then you come up with this number here in the lateral direction, so still about half of the wavelength of light. Now, probably all of you have heard that in 2014, there was the Nobel Prize awarded for the development of super-resolution fluorescence microscopy. It was given to these three gentlemen here, Eric Betzig, Stefan Hell, and W.E. Murner. And they have crossed this barrier or circumvented this diffraction barrier by using the properties of fluorophores, I would put it like this. So you've already heard in this winter school, I guess, a lot about organic dyes and about fluorescent proteins. And they've used both organic dyes and the fluorescent proteins. and the fact that you can use their photophysics and photochemistry to come up with this high resolution image. So there are two, I would say, two different categories of how you can overcome this resolution limit. One is the category that I would term targeted readout, where you look at your molecules or your sample as being covered by a density of molecules, and you use patterned illumination for this. I think you have already had a talk about STAD microscopy resolved and SIM, or focusing a little bit more on these aspects. I will be focusing more on the methods that use a stochastic readout, so where you treat your sample as being covered by individual single molecules, and the most prominent super resolution method is single molecule localization microscopy, or like the group of methods, but there are also others such as SOFI or 3B microscopy. Now, when we do localization microscopy, we take advantage that we can, with current cameras and wide field microscope or turf microscope, light sheet microscope, we can image single molecules. We see the point spread function of the single molecule, and we can determine, although this single molecule gives you a diffraction limited spot, we can determine the center of this spot very, very precisely. And the precision with which we can do this scales with the number of the photons that we collect. So the brighter the molecules we have, the more precise we can do this estimate. Then we build up our image from having your target structure labeled with a lot of single molecules. Come up with some way of switching these molecules on and off. And it's important that this switching is stochastic and that we only switch on a few of these molecules, such that on our, in one image, on our target structure, we can see the individual point spread functions, localize them very accurately, and then from doing this repeatedly over many image frames, we come to our super resolution image. Now, this switching can be done in many ways. We need at least two different states from which we switch back and forth, and most of the methods have been using fluorescence for this. So going from fluorescent to a non-fluorescent form. But you can imagine that you could also use other properties of labels to do this. Now, this random switching can be done, as I said, in many different ways. You can use the photophysics or photochemistry of the probes. You could also use binding and unbinding of the probes. I think you had already a talk by Philip Tinnefeld, and he probably showed you something about DNA paint imaging. So a lot of different ways, and you see correspondingly the many, many different acronyms that have come up for this. Everyone who comes up with a little bit different variety of this microscopy gives it its own name. But the most well-known, I would think, are still STORM, PALM, and then PAINT or DNA PAINT. And here I'm going to focus on PALM. So for PALM, you use fluorescent proteins to do this switching. And there are, you can categorize these fluorescent proteins into three classes. Or the ones where we start out with a dark fluorescent protein and photoactivated. Then you have some proteins that can switch back and forth between this dark form and the bright form. And you have another class of proteins that can be photoconverted from one fluorescent form to a fluorescent form with a different wavelength. And this photo activation or photo conversion is typically done with UV light. And just very recently, I think some of the people are sitting here in the room who have used new mechanism, primed photo conversion, where you use blue light and infrared light to do this photo conversion of the fluorophores. So this is very nice because the combination of blue light and infrared light is less phototoxic than the UV light that we typically use for switching the proteins. So here are a few examples of fluorescent proteins. And in the lab of Alexandra, we like to use MEOS fluorescent protein. And for two color, we often combine it with PSCFP2. Now, well, just to quick recap for PALM, we do then often start out with a dark, initially dark structure. Then we activate a sparse subset of the fluorescent proteins. We image them, localize them, and then we do this over and over again to accumulate our super resolved image. Now, the resolution depends on the localization precision, as I've already said, but it also depends on the molecular density with which you can decorate your structure and also on the size of your fluorescent protein. Not going to go into detail with that. So here are some of the very first PALM data from Eric Betzig in 2006. So he used the fluorescent protein Keide. And you see here images of thin slices of cells from where he labeled lysosomes. You see here the diffraction limited image. And here in comparison, the super resolved image where he got a resolution or line width of around 10 nanometers. Another sample from the same publication looked at, again, COS7 cells, thin fractions, and this time they used the fluorescent protein MEOS. Here they looked at mitochondria. And what they did in comparison is to look at here the super resolved fluorescence image, but use an overlay with transmission electron microscopy, because this was the first time that you really did super resolution microscopy. It was very nice to do this in the correlative manner to really convince people that, well, this method is working. So now I want to go and take this one step further and not only talk about how we can get a structure that has a high resolution, but how we can really go beyond that and read out more quantitative information from our localization images. Because as I said, we're interested really in the proteins, and with the localization microscopy, we can get very high resolution, but we do not routinely reach really resolution down to a single protein. So if we want to know more about how these proteins are organized, to know how they are functioning, we need to see what else can we do in our data analysis. So here you see on the right one of the very, very first attempts to do this. It's imaging of chemotaxis proteins in E. coli, where they looked at the spatial organization of these proteins, and what you can immediately see is that, well, there are different forms of organization. There is little dots, bigger clusters, and very, very big clusters. But how can we say more than just saying, ah, this is small, this is big, by looking at it? We need to come up with ways to analyze this in a systematic manner. And ultimately, we would also like to know in one of these clusters how many molecules are there really. So from our super resolution data set, we collect a number of positions of localizations. And then what can we learn from these? In the next step would be from these many, many localizations that we collect to convert this into a number of labels. So how many fluorescent proteins do we have in our sample and how are they arranged? And then in the end, to go one step further from the number of fluorescent proteins, to really go and say, now I have so and so many of my protein molecules that I have tagged with my fluorescent protein in my sample. You see here a little bit the roadmap of super-resolution microscopy as depicted by Katharina Gauss. So you have the first events of single molecule imaging in the 90s, and then the first Palm data by Eric Betzig and others in 2006. And then from about 2010 to now, people have tried to get the most out of this super resolution data sets. And actually, Palm microscopy using fluorescent proteins seems like the perfect candidate to do so. Why is that? Because you have a one-to-one stoichiometry between your fluorescent protein and the protein of interest. So this is already a good start. Now the next thing that you have to ask yourself, can I really say when I detect one localization in my image, can I count this as one fluorescent protein? So also Palm, as I described you, these different classes of fluorescent proteins, you would think that you start out by saying the photoconvertible ones, a green one, you switch it on, you come to one red fluorescent protein, you localize it in your image, and then it's bleached and gone. But is that really the case? If it would be the case, it would be super easy to count molecules. But of course it's not. So in Alexandra's group in 2010, they were one of the first that took a closer look into what is really happening in the photophysics of these fluorescent proteins that you use for Palm. So here you see some data where they purified MEOS fluorescent proteins and dispersed them at single molecule level in a polymer matrix, and then looked one by one, what is the photophysics of these proteins? And they discovered that, surprise, surprise, it is not that easy. So you do not just switch on with 405 one protein, you see it, you localize it, and it's bleached, but you have reappearances, you have blinking in your trace. So they quantified this under different conditions. So here you have a pulsed, short pulse with 405 laser, you image with the green laser, and you see when you look at the different molecules of MEOS that you always have some switching on, and then you have intermittence in your trace of the molecule. And when they quantified it under these conditions, they found out that they're like 50% of the MEOS molecules do that. So you cannot just go, I have one localization, I have one MEOS protein. So the blinking or the switching of the proteins, it enables you to do super resolution, but it also complicates the interpretation of your localization microscopy data. So either you're lucky, you find a fluorescent protein that really just goes and makes one blink, but most of them don't. It's much more complicated. They do go to different dark states. So in this case, it means you have to know your fluorophore when you want to get quantitative information out of your sample. So how do you get to know your fluorophore? Well, you investigate it in detail under different conditions. Here, the group of Alexandra went and characterized the MEOs under different illumination conditions. And for example, when you go for, not for pulsed 405, but for low levels of longer 405 excitation, they found out that the dark time, so the time between the blinks of MEOs, is shortened. And then you can do all the statistics on your traces of the MEOs that you collect. You can investigate how many times does it blink. What is the distribution of the dark times between the blinks? What is the distribution on the of the on times, of the fluorescent on times? And then use this to convert the number of the many blinks into how many molecules you have. So how can you do this? The idea that they came up with is, I would say, it's rather simple. You have here, again, an example of six traces of MEOs fluorescence. And now they said, when we characterize the length of these off times here, and we come up with a certain dark time that we allow the molecule to be off, and then group everything that is every off time that is smaller than this dark time together, then we can get rid of this blinking effect. So you see here a little bit what I mean. When you take a low dark time that you allow, you start to already decrease the number of blinks that you see from 13 counts to 9 counts. When you increase this, you decrease further to 7 counts, and then when you have the optimal dark time that you allow, you end up with the 6 counts that are really the 6 MEOs molecules that you had in your sample. So taking this idea one step further, you make measurements, you complement it with a lot of simulations, and then you can investigate systematically how you have to set this dark time to get your molecule counts as accurately as possible. So what you see here is in black measurements of the MEOs traces, and in red fit of a model, and in addition, in blue, you see the simulation. And on the y-axis is depicted the number of blinks that you have in your sample, and on the x-axis, you increase the dark time. So when you have a very short dark time, you count all the blinks, so you have a lot of double or more than double counts of the molecules. As you increase the dark time, you make less mistakes, so you make less overcounting. The number of molecules that you count goes down. And at some point, when you go over a certain dark time, you also start to increase your error. You start to miss blinks. So there's an optimum dark time to apply to come to the accurate number of fluorescent protein molecules that you see. And you can do this, of course, for several different fluorescent proteins. You see here, this is MEOs, where we Alexandra's group did a lot of measurements. And when you do this for photoactivatable GFP, you see that this curve of counts with increasing dark time is very, very flat. So this means that the PA-GFP does not blink as much as MEOs. And when you go to DRONPA, which is one of the reversibly switchable fluorescent proteins, then it changes still for the very big dark times, and this is because you have a lot of switching cycles of the DRONPA, like it blinks a lot. So here you see then the first control experiments that they did in the group. It's they fused MEOs protein with a peptide that goes to the cell membrane, but that is a control for one protein that is not clustering in the membrane, that will just be on its own and should be randomly distributed on the cell surface. You see here the diffraction limited image, here the palm image with all the localizations that are plotted, and D from D, E, F to G, you increase the dark time that you allow. So you group more and more of the localizations together to approach the true number of fluorescent proteins in the image. And they figured out that with this, they can achieve coming to the correct number of fluorescent proteins within an error of about 5%. So if you have some questions or if something is unclear, just go ahead and ask. Yep. I'll come to that later in the talk. Okay, so this is still, yes, as said, on the overcounting issue. And here we looked at how can we see that we don't see fake clusters in this protein that should be randomly distributed. And this is just an ad for visualization. You see here the time frame of the recording of the movie as progresses, and you see the blinks here of this negative clustering control with MEOS color-coded in time. So you see that you have, when you do not correct for the blinking, these fake clusters coming up. So when you have a cluster that has all the same color, it points to being just due to blinking. Now if you use your appropriate dark time blinking corrected image, you can recover what the real fluorescent protein distribution in the sample, so your random distribution. And now looking at this with a positive control, where you would expect clustering, here this is a G protein coupled receptor, it's labeled with MEOS again, and here also already corrected for the dark time, and now you see when you look over time that you have real clusters being indicated by them being composed of dots, localizations that have different colors. So they appear randomly spaced in time. Now, when you want to quantify further, what is the degree of clustering in your sample? One method that the group of Alexandra has started out using very early on is the so-called clustering investigation by using Ripley's functions. And when you do analysis with these Ripley's functions, what you do is you get an overall measure of the clustering in your sample. So the idea here is that you go on one localization, then you look in a certain radius around this localization, what is the density of fluorescent proteins versus the overall average density of your sample. And like this, you can figure out whether this local density is, you have more or less molecules than you would expect when you have a random distribution of your proteins on the surface. You do this for increasing radius, and then there are a couple of convenient transformations that you can do with this Ripley's K function to come up with the Ripley's H function. I'm just going to leave it at this. It's convenient transformations. It means that when you go to this Ripley's H function, then you can see if you have clustering over a certain spatial scale by looking if this H function is bigger than zero or smaller than zero. So higher than zero indicates that you have clustering in your sample, and lower than zero indicates that you have a certain regularity or certain dispersion in your sample. So looking at this, Alexandra's group investigated clustering in cardiomyocytes of this beta-2 adrenergic receptors. And going to walk you through this. So you see, as a first, so always you always do controls. As a first control, again, they looked at this non-clustering peptide with MEOs. You see this here in the green line. So you have a very, very slight positive value. So this is already blinking corrected data. Now, when we go to this beta 2 adrenergic receptor, which you see here, the image in A already blinking corrected, then you see that the Ripley's H function is in red here. You have some clustering in your sample, and it's mostly at around 100 nanometers, it's the highest. And now they wanted to see how can they influence this clustering when they treat the sample with different drugs. And the first thing that they did is looked at how does the clustering change when you change the cholesterol content of your sample. So they did this with two different drugs. You see it in the blue and in the yellow graph. But this G-protein coupled receptor seems to not really change its spatial distribution when you change the cholesterol content. However, if you interfere with the actin cytoskeleton of the cells by using cytokalasin, then you go to the black line that you see here. So you go back to a level of clustering the same as the negative control. So this means that the clustering of this G-protein coupled receptor does not depend on the cholesterol content in the membrane, but it's sensitive to the actin cytoskeleton integrity. A variant of this, analyzing the overall clustering in membranes, is to not use the Ripley's function, which I showed you here. They look at at a certain radius from the point and look at the average density across this whole circle, but to use instead pair correlation analysis. And here in this pair correlation analysis, you do no longer look at a whole area, but you rather look at a defined radius from your point. How does the density of points differ from a random distribution? So this has a couple of convenient features. It means that you can look at the really the spatial organization at a certain distance from the molecules, and you can now go to another way of correcting for the blinking in your sample. And this is by exploiting the spatial organization of blinking that comes from the same fluorescent protein molecule. So when you repeatedly have localized the blinking that comes from a single fluorescent protein, then these blinking events will be distributed according to the localization uncertainty of your measurement. And this is exactly what you can a measure with the pair correlation function with a control sample. So here they did a control sample not with a peptide that is randomly distributed in the membrane, but they rather use the protein that they purified, throw it on the surface at a low concentration, and then measure the pair correlation function, which you see here And then they can take apart the two components of the correlation function, the one that is due to the stochastic blinking on the size of the PSF, so which comes really from the multiple localizations of the fluorescent protein, which is here depicted in blue. And then they have no more correlations. So what is left over is just a flat line around one. Now you can use this control measurement when you go to a protein that is clustered. Here they looked at the transferrin receptor. You see here the localizations from the measurement directly. Here a little zoom in. And now when you calculate the pair correlation function, you have a mix of the correlations due to clustering of the receptor and due to this multiple blinking, but you can take it apart. You can fit it separately because you know the component of the stochastic blinking for multiple localizations from your control sample, and then you're left with the green part here, which you can say this is due to the real clustering of the underlying protein distribution, and fit this with an exponential function that describes, tells you something about the cluster size. So this is just a variant of these overall measures for clustering. And you can, of course, not only do this with one color and one protein, but you can also use it to investigate the spatial relative spatial organization of two different species by labeling them with two different fluorescent proteins. So here you see an example where they induced, where they looked at GPI anchor and photoactivatable GFP in the membrane, and then also they labeled the actin with photoactivatable mCherry. And you have the first sample where you would expect when you just put this GPI anchor in the membrane that it would be randomly distributed. This is also what you measure when you have corrected for the blinking, and the same. And there's also not really a correlation here between the actin and the GPI anchor. But now when you induce clustering by throwing an antibody that cross-links the GFP proteins on the cell, then you get these sort of fake clusters. And at the same time, when you use the pair correlation analysis for the cross-correlation analysis, you can see that you have in the clustering of the GPI anchor leads to a co-clustering of the actin, which is actually underneath the cell membrane. So there seems to be some sort of mechanism that translates the organization on top to the organization on the bottom. So any questions to that? Okay, then I'll continue. And this is the last version of how you can analyze clustering on the overall spatial scale. Here, this is a completely different method. So this is not trying to correct for blinking or using fancy analysis methods, but rather it uses the trick of doing solving this experimentally. So of increasing the, you use different samples that have a different labeling density. And what can you learn from this? If you imagine you have a homogeneously distributed protein in your sample, then when you increase the labeling density, you expect the relative area that is covered by the clusters to increase. So you look here, the relative area by the of the clusters would increase when you increase the labeling density, so when you increase the numbers of localizations that you can get. But the number of localizations that you get from per cluster, because they are only due to the blinking of the molecules, would be constant. You see this here in this line. Now, when you imagine you have a protein that is really forming true clusters, then eventually the area that's clustered that is covered by clusters would saturate when you increase the labeling density, but the localizations per cluster will increase. Now, when you plot these two parameters, the eta and the rho, so the relative area that is covered by the clusters and the density of localizations per cluster against each other, you can use this to discriminate between random protein distribution and clustered protein distribution. So random would be almost a flat line, and clustered would increase with the labeling density. So see this here, the first experiments that they did was like an engineered experiment. The random distribution they created by just throwing the protein on the surface, labeled protein on the surface with different degrees of labeling. And the clustered distribution they created by micropatterning of proteins on the surface. Here, the streptavidin, and you also hear from here, 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 you increase the number of labels. Then they do their analysis, and you see that, as expected, here in the random distribution, you get a flat line, and your engineered clusters, you see that it's significant, it deviates from this random line that is plotted here. So it's a very convenient way of circumventing all the artifacts that you can have in your images and to get an answer, do I have clustering or do I not have clustering? But it's at the expense of having to measure different samples with different labeling densities as opposed to just making one measurement. So how can you circumvent this? Well, you could try when you do palm experiment to already in your one sample find different samples that maybe have a different expression level of your protein. And by this, you would have your differently labeled samples. Or you do it in a bit more clever way. You do not measure different samples, but you look at your sample at different time points. So you, if you look at an early time point of measurements, you will not have accumulated many localizations, and you can use this as the not very densely labeled sample, and then you look at later time points and accumulate the localizations. This will then represent your more and more and more densely labeled samples. You can do the same kind of analysis as before, and which is then, well, very convenient for you. Here, again, I show you an example where they looked at this by accumulating the number of labels to show that it works. So here you see the clathrin light chain of MEOs under two different conditions on the cell membrane. One condition where you have clusters and one condition where you have randomly distributed molecules, and you can still do the same kind of analysis. So you can, for the clustered, you have this line of rho versus eta going up, whereas when you have a random distribution, you really have the flat line. So that's a very convenient and easy way to look at this, in my opinion. But you only get the answer clustered or not clustered, and nothing more about what's the size of the clusters and so on and so forth. So now we want to go from this global measures of clustering, which I've shown you, the Ripley's functions, the PCF, or this varying labeling density method, to really say something about individual clusters. Because these global clustering measures, they have certain disadvantages. They have problems when you have very inhomogeneous sample. They have problems when your cluster shape is very asymmetric. So now I'm going to show you some ways how to look at individual clusters. And the first one comes from a study that one of our organizers has done, Ulrike. I don't know, is she here? Okay, well, she knows her research, so I'll show you a little bit about this. So she was investigating in this study the spatial organization of bacterial nucleic acids synthesis. So she was looking at RNA polymerase in, I think this were E. coli cells, and she had these RNA polymerase labeled with MEOs. It seems to be one of the favorite fluorescent proteins. Well, it's nice, it's very bright. And what you can see immediately from the images here, where you see all the localizations, is that there seems to be some patterning. There's some big structures here, some band-like structures, but there's also structures that are underneath these big structures. So they figured out that these bigger band structures, they are depending on the cell cycle and on the size of the E. coli, but when they wanted to look into the smaller structures, they needed to use a different way of looking at the clustering, and what they used is so-called density-based spatial clustering of applications with noise, or short dbScan method. And here it's a method that really looks at the clustering, enables you to look at the clustering at a small scale. So this, how does this work? The dbScan has two parameters. It looks at the number of points, min points, that are in the neighborhood of a localization, and it does this within a certain radius, epsilon. So if a localization is has at least min point neighbors in an environment of epsilon, then it's connected to these neighbors. And you see here an example. All the red and yellow localizations, they are density connected to their neighbors, and they all belong to one cluster. And you see, whoops, I'm sorry. You see the blue point, it does not have any neighbor in its epsilon environment, so it's just considered as background. And then you can do statistics on the size of the identified clusters. So they did this. They looked at the RNA polymerase. Oh, I'm sorry, here they looked at the RNA polymerase with photoactivatable mCherry. And they looked on this clustering on the small scale under different conditions. And you see, as a control, they looked at the free pamCherry. You see that you have only very, very small clusters, or not really clusters. These are just a few randomly overlapping molecules. Whereas when you look at the RNA polymerase that is labeled with the pamCherry, then you see, especially under enriched mediums, when the RNA polymerase is really getting to work, you see that you have significant amounts here of clusters at spatial scales of slightly less than 100 nanometers, but also you have clusters that are even larger. So their hypothesis was that the clusters that are on the 100 nanometer scale, they come from RNA polymerases that sit on one operon of DNA, and that these other ones here are probably due to multiple operons or due to clusters that are overlapping, because they did 2D analysis, and of course there's a 3D spatial organization of the proteins in the cell. So this, the dbScan algorithm. Now I come to the last algorithm that I want to show you, and it's also I think, the newest of the algorithms that I presented. It's a so-called SR-Tesseller algorithm. So it comes from a group of Jean-Baptiste Siperita in Bordeaux, and they are using Voronoi tessellation. This is actually an image analysis or segmentation technique that has been around, I think, for a long time, but just not really applied to single molecule data analysis, but to 3D data analysis in general. So for example, for 3D modeling. How does this work? So in this tessellation analysis, you consider your localizations as seeds. You see them here depicted in the small blue dots. You start with two seeds. You draw the bisector of these seeds. Then you add more and more of these seeds into your image, and always draw the bisecting line. So it gets more and more complex until you have considered all the different seats, and by this you have constructed the so-called Voronoi polygons, and you can then look and at these polygons. You have the original seat that you started with, then you have the all the neighboring polygons of first, so-called first rank, depicted here in yellow, and in the more pale yellow are then the second rank polygons. You can use these polygons now to calculate different parameters about your sample. You can calculate, for example, the polygon area, the shape of these polygons, the distance. You can add information of the distance from one seat to another. You can calculate the overall density of these polygons in the sample and use this to look at your clusters. So you, how do you do this typically? Here you see an example of a fibroblast where focal adhesion proteins are marked. Again, this time really integrin with MEOS2. And the way you would do this, you would run your tessellation algorithm. Then you would calculate the statistics of all the parameters that are available that I've talked about. And then you use one or several of these parameters, pick a threshold for this parameter. And then based on this parameter, you define your clusters. So the and all the polygons that are above the threshold for these parameters, you merge them and you connect the outlines of the clusters that are at the borders. And the nice thing is that this clustering seems to work very nicely for parameter thresholds that you can set semi-automatically. So you see, they started by first segmenting the outline of the cell by looking at the first rank density parameter. So if they considered all the polygons that have a density that is bigger than 2 times the average density of polygons, of localizations and polygons of the entire image, and this first gives you the outline of the cell. Then in the next step, they looked for the big clusters of the focal adhesions by looking at the density that are bigger than 2 times the average density within the cell. So this gives you the second level of big clusters. And then repeated this to come to the really dense protein assemblies here in dark green within the focal adhesions. So they did a comparison of this clustering algorithm with dbScan and with replay function-based clustering, and have seen with simulations that here in the red you have the results of the clustering area as determined with this SR tessellation method, that it's relatively robust. Even if you go to relatively high background densities, you can still recover your clusters quite faithfully. Another example here is where they looked at neurons. And here it was the GLU-A receptor, again labeled with MEOS. And again, did the same kind of semi-automated cluster analysis. They could segment the outline of the neuron, then the clusters of these receptors in the neuron. And now the nice part is, as the dbScan, this method works for arbitrary cluster shape. And you can really compare then here, as an example, the cluster diameter. You see for this receptor here labeled with MEOS, it's the distribution in red. You have cluster diameters around 100 nanometers, whereas when you use this GPI anchor that I've already talked about a bit earlier, it's randomly distributed. You see them very small diameters if you have groups of this proteins that you find. And you can, of course, do all kinds of other analysis on these polygons. For example, look at the surface that is covered versus the number of clusters that are on the surface, and so on and so forth. So So much to the different clustering methods. Here's a little bit of an overview in the end. So I've shown you how you can use Ripley's K function, how you can use pair correlations, dbScan, and tessellation. And of course, there are some more clusters. So this is just for you if you are interested and want to look this up. A few more methods that I have mentioned. But now I want to go in the last part of the presentation, really not analyze the spatial organization, also clustering or no clustering and clustering shape, but really go to how many molecules do we really have in these clusters. So as we've seen, so far we've only treated the overcounting problem, so the blinking, and we have looked at it so far only in the context of creating artificial clusters, but not really the number of molecules. So causes for overcounting, mainly the blinking, but of course also if you pick up background localizations. So sources for undercounting, and so far I'm only talking about functional labels that I detect in the image. Sources for undercounting would be, we have not imaged all molecules, so we have just not photoactivated or photoconverted all molecules, or our algorithm fails. So we have too high background, or we have excluded them because it might be multiple emitters that are on at the same time. Going again a little bit into accounting for blinking, because it's the, I would say, one of the major it's the major source for overcounting. I'm going to go over this very quickly because it's actually the same thing that, or more or less the same thing as we did for the clustering. No? Okay, it's a bit more advanced here in this analysis, but again, it is looking at the MEOs and MEOs photoblinking, and also they did a comparison with another fluorescent protein, Dendra2, but they started out with similar idea as before, to characterize the photophysics of the protein in detail. So looking at the photophysical model, that is very similar. So you have a photo conversion, then you allow for a dark state, and you allow for bleaching. And you characterize, again, off times, on times, the time to bleaching, or the number of the blinks that you have, that you measure. And in the first overview analysis, they compared these two proteins, and they figured, as opposed to a lot of the studies before, we prefer to use Dendra2 versus MEOs because it blinks much less than MEOs in their hands, under their conditions. However, it photobleaches faster, and it is also dimmer than MEOs. I think most of people like to use MEOs because it's so bright. And then here you see actually the statistics about the number of blinks in a sample under certain condition. And you see when you use the same idea of this dark time for grouping the number of localizations, how for MEOs you have really a large distribution of blinks, which goes to less blinks when you use the dark time analysis. So here, zero, you have really a lot of blinks. When you start grouping with 2 seconds, you get the red distribution. You don't get so many blinks anymore. And then with blue, with a very a high dark time, you eliminate more and more the overcounting due to the blinks. With Dendra, you see immediately you have less of a problem with the blinking in their hands. And you only need a very low, a short dark time to account for the Dendra photoblinking. But this was only the simplified picture. What they did actually is do a lot of experiments and simulations to figure out how they can optimize both the illumination and how they can optimize how they choose this dark time. So you can imagine when you have advantages for palm microscopy, for quantification, but also for normal palm microscopy would be that you really sparsely activate your fluorescent proteins. And in the beginning, you have a lot of fluorescent proteins in your sample, so you need only a little bit of the UV light to photoconvert them. And then with time, your reservoir of fluorescent proteins is not activated yet is less and less. So you need more light to activate the same amount of proteins. So they figured out that rather than taking constant illumination to do the photoconversion or photoactivation, they would use a Fermi function to optimize this. And when they use this optimized illumination, they disperse the blinks from the photoactivation and from the molecules over time in optimal manner. And then they also saw when they did simulations that the optimal dark time to use for the blinking correction actually depends on the number of molecules that you have in a cluster. So this is a very important thing to take into account. When you do this dark time correction, which is here, dark time, where this is the number of blinks, or actually here directly the counting bias, you see that when you have 140, so a big number of molecules, this curve behaves very differently from when you have a low number, say here 20 of molecules. So they came up with an algorithm that iteratively optimizes this dark time. So in order to make the, well, the least error. You see here, when they use the optimized grouping, dark time grouping, they make really low an error that is, it was on the order of 2 to 5%. Whereas when you would not take into account that you have you have to use different dark time for different number of molecules, you could really, really end up in trouble. And they use this to investigate first a counting standard. So because this is one of the very first palm experiments where they used palm for counting, they picked the flagellar motor of E. coli, and this flagellar motor and the phlegm molecule that they looked at with Dendra is very well known from electron microscopy, that it has 34 subunits. And then they went ahead and did their palm analysis. One must say that when they did their palm analysis, they did a lot of selection criteria on their spots. So they used here the advantage that you have these clusters or these motor subunits that you see only a few of them in one E. coli. So you have these diffraction limited spots that you can actually discern from each other. And then they looked, okay, we are going to take the diffraction limited spots that are round and that satisfy a number of other criteria due to the biology of where they occur in the cell. And when they did this now, you see here the comparison of when they would just use the number of blinks. You see here in red, this is what they would deduce from the number of molecules, whereas when they optimize this dark time, you see the distribution in blue, then they can really recover the number of subunits quite accurately. You see that they come up with a mean of 33 plus minus 1, which agrees very well with the electron microscopy picture. So this was one of the very first where you use palm for counting. Already seen in this previous image that it's very good idea to use standards, to use well-known protein oligomers to figure out if you've done everything right in your analysis, as good as you can. So this is why I wanted to tell you here about the number of standards that you can easily use in your experiments. It's a number of multimers, so 10 mer, 12 mers, and 24 mers, which are bacterial proteins and which you can express in a number of different cell lines. So you can express them in bacteria, you can express them in mammalian cells, and this comes from the group of Mike Heilemann. And here you see examples of these different oligomers here tagged with just a normal YFP. You see how you have an increase in the intensity when you disperse these molecules in a single molecule regime on the surface, but they also did quantitative palm measurements. In fact, it was not palm measurements that they did, but they did storm measurements. But I anyway wanted to show you this because I like this idea of using the defined standards. And they used storm with a SnapTag fused proteins. And you see, so why did they need to use storm in this case and cannot just go for the same idea as the other group where they looked at the diffraction limited spots? Well, because they were interested in the end, in looking at a protein that is very, very, very dense. So what they wanted to look at is the nuclear pore complex, or specifically the NUP107 complex, which is on the nuclear envelope. And when you look at in the confocal, with the confocal microscope, you can see there are some points, but it's not really such that you can really see the individual complexes of these nuclear pores, but you really need to use super-resolution microscopy. So here you see the super-resolution images that they did, and then they did count the number of localizations that they have per cluster. And what they did here, they did not really correct for the number of blinks, but rather just looked at the what do I count with my standard protein, and what do I count with a complex that I'm interested in. So with their standard protein, they took it as a reference and to then convert the number of blinks that they have with the protein they're interested in, so this NUP132 or the NUP43, which are both components of this NUP107 complex, and then they could come up with, yes, our proteins that we're interested in, they seem to be something close to 30. And the question that is out there in the community is this NUP107 complex rather composed of 16 or 32 subunits? So from their analysis, they could say, yeah, it's rather 32. So now I come to the last part. She asked already about the undercounting. So up to now, we've considered mostly the effects due to photoblinking, which allowed us to convert the number of localizations to a number of functional fluorescent proteins. And but of course, functional fluorescent proteins does not mean number of proteins of interest. So what can go wrong? The fluorescent protein can, for example, not mature completely or misfold, then it will not be fluorescent. Or the fluorescent protein is not photoconverted correctly, so not switched on or not switched to the proper wavelengths. Or something else happens, it's prematurely photobleached, for example. So how can we figure out if this is happening in our sample? Well, I would say again, a nice answer is to say, okay, we're going to use calibration standards for that. So we are going to use proteins where we know the number of subunits and then go into this in detail. I'll show you in a minute. But actually something else that we have to consider and that a lot of people, I think, maybe forget about a little bit, or it's like, I would say, the last step of converting to really number of proteins is that you also have to consider the way that you introduce your fluorescent protein into the sample. So if you choose a cell line and a protein to look at where the cell line does not express this protein and then you introduce your fluorescent protein construct, then all the protein of interest fusions should have the fluorescent protein on. But a lot of times we introduce the fluorescent protein into a cell line that also expresses the wild type protein. So you have actually a mix of this. And you need to properly take this into account. There are different ways of doing this. One way would be, for example, to look at a quantitative Western blot, or to try to silence the expression of the wild-type protein. Or, ideally, nowadays, we have these tools, CRISPR-Cas, to really put the fluorescent protein in the place of the wild-type protein. So, now back to how do you determine what is the labeling efficiency of your fluorescent protein. So here, there has been one big study where they used protein standard, the glycine receptor in Xenopus laevis oocytes. So this is a convenient was a convenient system for them to use, because this receptor does not is not expressed in these frogs. And this receptor is composed of three alpha subunits and two beta subunits. And they made a lot of different fusion constructs with fluorescent proteins, tagging both sometimes the alpha subunit, sometimes the beta subunit. And then they analyzed how many fluorescent molecules you can you detect per glycine receptor. And they did this in two different ways. So one is they used single molecule counting by palm, by using the method that I've just explained to you, by using this dark time cutoff. Or what they also did is use single step photobleaching. So this single step photobleaching means that you start out with all your proteins, and then you just illuminate them with your fluorescent light, and they will then eventually be photodestroyed one by one. And if you have such a low number of subunits, you can relatively easily recognize these bleaching steps. This is not always the case. If you have high noise, or if you have a lot of subunits, it will become increasingly difficult to really discern these photobleaching steps, and there are a lot of computational math tools that can help you to still do this photobleaching analysis. But here, three and two subunits, so this photobleaching analysis was relatively okay to do. So the advantage of this photobleaching analysis is that you can do this when you have a photoconvertible fluorescent protein. You can do this before you do the photoconversion, so in the green form of the protein, and you can do it after you have photoconverted the protein in the red form of the protein. Whereas when you use the single molecule counting palm, you can only do it when you do the photoconversion, so you can only do it for the red form of the protein. So they did a lot of the measurements. And now the trick is how you analyze these measurements. And the analysis is done by, here you see, by measuring these distributions. So they measure either by photobleaching step analysis, the number of steps, and do this for an ensemble of proteins, or, as I said, with a palm analysis, and then apply this photoblinking correction. And then you fit these distributions with a binomial distribution. So why is that so? When you have, you know that you have, in this case, it was the subunit where you have three subunits in the protein, you know that you have a maximum of three subunits. So the number, you do three trials of looking, do I have a fluorescent protein or not? So you have a certain probability of one fluorescent protein to actually fluoresce or to be still dark. This is P. And then you do successive number of trials, K trials, which is here the number of steps that you detect, to see how many of these proteins you count. So this is perfectly described by the binomial distribution. And then you fit your data, and as a fixed parameter, you know the number of subunits that your protein has. K, the probability for K is what you have measured, and you have P as the free parameter. P will be the probability of your protein to be fluorescent. Is that okay? And now it comes out a big table. Okay, I think I might run a little bit over time. Let's see. It comes out a big table with a lot of different values, but I'm going to simplify it a bit. So with the photobleaching analysis for the green form, they saw that about 65% to 80% of the fluorescent proteins are actually fluorescent. So you're missing quite a few, but it gets even worse when you look at the red form of the protein. So when you photoconvert the protein, turns out that most of the proteins, you have only 40% to 60% of the photoconverted proteins that are fluorescent. And you need to take this into account in your analysis, otherwise you are severely undercounting. And one interesting feature of the study is that they also looked at this over time. So when you photoconvert with a 405 laser for longer and longer times, you will increase the more and go more and more and more to the red form. And what they could see is that initially, when you sum up how much green form and how much red form you have, you actually get to almost 100% of fluorescent protein, but in the green form, ultimately you only started out with 80% of fluorescent molecules for MEOs. So it means that there are some dark green fluorescence molecules that are actually able to photoconvert and that make a functional red protein. Whereas when you go to the long times of photoactivation, you actually have a green form that is remaining in the end. So there is some green protein that cannot photoconvert, actually a lot of green protein that cannot photoconvert. So how do we take this into account? And I'll come to the very last set of experiments that I want to talk about. Well, it's a little bit different take on correcting for blinking and correcting for the photoconversion efficiency at the same time. So what the researchers did here is they looked not only at the number of blinks and counted the number of blinks of the protein, but they look at not at the number of localizations per protein, but they look at the number of blinks per protein and then model this. And in the first step, they model the number of blinks to recover in a very similar way as I've just shown you with the glycine receptor. In the glycine receptor research, they figure out the how much of the fluorescent protein is actually fluorescent. So here, P is the fraction of not fluorescing protein, so really it matches with the measurement that we had before. About 70% of the MEOs is fluorescent. And then in the next step, you look at your sample of interest, look again at the distribution of the number of blinks, and actually you can fit this, you can show when you look at the kinetics scheme, which I'm not going to go into detail now, is that you can show this with a negative binomial distribution, and then you have as a fixed parameter the P, the probability to be not fluorescent, and you can recover N. So here this is some results from, I think it was a study that Clarissa was part of, or Joël was part of, so someone who's now working for Dominic. So they looked at a couple of proteins where the oligomerization state is known. So again, the monomer to figure out the P, the probability to be not fluorescent, then here the dimer and the trimer, and not surprisingly, they come up with numbers that are less than 2 and less than 3, because here the dark fraction of MEOs is not considered, but you can actually do this. You can, but it means that you have to do a second set of calibration probes. So you then look at the distribution of your blinking probability with a monomer to first fit the probability not to blink. And then you also include the probability of the protein to be a fluorescent. And I'm sorry, I think I mixed it up on the last on the slide before. So you have to do two controls, one to account for blinking and one to account for the dark fraction. And they did this, and this is the very last slide that I'm going to show you on experiments on. They did this to investigate the TLR4, the toll-like receptors in Hex cells. So here the trick was that this receptor is not expressed in the Hex cells, so they do not need to consider the wild-type protein and so on. And they could show that under different conditions, so when they stimulate the cells, that they can really see different states of the receptor. So they can take apart whether this receptor occurs as a monomer or as a dimer, or to which extent, to which proportion it is a monomer and a dimer. And they could, do this by using really these two different calibrations and then looking at the sample of interest. So I'm going to wrap it up with this. Here is one more counting approach that you can look up when you're interested in it. And this is my last slide. So I've shown you how you can count molecules using palm or storm microscopy, but in fact, and also we've touched a little bit on bleaching step analysis, but in fact there are is a multitude of different methods that you can use for counting the number of molecules or inferring the concentration of molecules in your biological sample. And depending on really what you want to know, what biological system you look at, what kind of microscopy method you have available, you need to always be very careful and choose the method that suits your sample best. And with this, I'd like to thank you for your attention. And also I would like to thank Alexandra well for giving me the opportunity to speak here on her behalf. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Christine, for that talk. Unfortunately, we don't have time for questions, but Christine will be around for dinner, and I ask you swiftly to move to dinner because they want to start serving.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.